Hi all of you, and today we are dealing with the last chapter of class 7th quality book, and it talks about equality. So when I say equality, there is something that comes to your mind, and when I say equality, most of us start thinking about inequality. This is how we perceive equality, by getting an image of inequality that is so prevalent in our society. But what actually does equality mean? Does it mean that everyone should have equal wealth, property, money, or does it mean that people must have equal access to resources and an opportunity to hone and better their skills? So let us try to examine what the NCERT books tells us. Poverty and the lack of resources continue to be a key reason why so many people live in India, lives in India are highly unequal. So it's a fact. It's a fact that because of poverty and inequality, people in India are living a very unequal life. Unequal life means that some of us are very rich and some of us are very, very poor. And those who are very poor do not even have the bare minimum necessities of life. What is bare minimum necessity? When I ask you, it is food, clothing and shelter. These three things are the bare minimum. Once these things are done with, once these things are taken care of, only then one can move to the next level. That is luxuries, maybe some luxurious house or clothes, designer clothes or things like that. That first the essentials must be taken care of, and then comes the next stage. Now, moving ahead, what the chapter tells us here, that persons are discriminated against primarily because of their social and cultural background, as well as because they are women. So again, you see identities come into play. Something we have studied in our earlier lectures, that people have multiple identities: their religious identity, their regional identity, their caste identity, their gender identity. And when discrimination, when they are given meted unequal treatment because of any particular identity, this is what we call inequality. Discrimination on the basis of a person's religion, caste and sex is another significant factor for why people are treated unequally in India. Now, what are the several struggles that people have done? And here two stories are given. We will see them briefly. One is this Thaba Matasya Sangh. So let us try to understand what this Thaba Matasya Sangh does and why this story is in the NCERT book. When dams are built or forest areas declared sanctuaries for animals, thousands of people are displaced. People have to move. They have to live elsewhere, because these things, the space that is available there will be utilized for some other purpose. Whole villages are uprooted and people are forced to go and build new homes, start new lives elsewhere. Most of these people are poor. Urban areas to bastis. Bastis means a small cluster of people living there, in which poor people live, are often uprooted. Some of them are relocated to areas outside the city. Their work as well as their children's schooling is severely disrupted. See, entire livelihood is disturbed because people are not going to offices. They are doing some work in the vicinity of their residence. They are living there. They are engaged into some petty works which helps them to live a life, helps them to barely live a life, to meet the 2 days' meal. And this displacement of people and community is a problem that has become quite widespread in our country. In this chapter, we read about Thaba Matasya Sangh. Now, it's a federation of fisherworks cooperatives, an organization fighting for the rights of the displaced forest dweller of the Satpa village in Satpa forest in Madhya Pradesh. So, originating in Mahadev Hills, it talks about, it has gone haywire, just a minute. Here it is. Originating in Mahadev Hills of Chindwara district. Now this Satpura and Mahadev Hills will come very handy when you will study geography. The Thaba flows through Betul before joining the Narmada in Hoshangabad. It's the name of a local river. It's a tributary actually. Thaba Dam began to be built in 1958 and was completed in 1978. It took us 20 years to build one dam in those times. It submerged large areas of forest and agricultural land. Forest dwellers were left with nothing. Some of the displaced people settled around the reservoir, and apart from their meager farms, found a livelihood in fishing. They earned very little. In 1994, government gave the rights for fishing in the Thaba Reservoir to private contractors. These contractors drove the local people away and got cheap labor from outside. The contractors began to threaten the villagers who did not want to leave by bringing in hoodlums. Hoodlums mean the local goons. The villagers stood united and decided that it was time to set up an organization and do something to protect their rights. The newly formed Tawa Mata Sesang organized rallies and a takaja. Takaja means road blockade, demanding their rights to continue fishing for their livelihood. They have been displaced. Government sold the fishing rights to a private enterprise. Now these private enterprise brings in some cheap labor from outside who are ready to work for these private people for a lower cost than what these Tawa people were doing. So they started protesting and they said that we also must have fishing rights. In response to their protest, the government created a committee to assess the issue. The committee recommended that fishing rights be granted to the villagers for their livelihood. In 1996, the Madhya Pradesh government decided to give the people displaced by Tawa Dam the fishing rights for reservoir. 5-year lease agreement was signed. So just to tell you, these things were happening in 90s a lot. Now it's not possible because, you know, such incidences have occurred so much that government of the day has realized the fact that we cannot just drive away the indigenous population, bringing some cheap labor from outside and then carry on with the work. Now, if there is such a project, there is something called, this you will study, if you are reading newspapers, you will come across this term, SIA, Social Impact Assessment. If a dam is being built, if an industry is being put in some faraway place, then SIA will be done. That SIA would include, it would study, it would analyze how this project is going to affect the indigenous population. Okay, not only whose land it belongs to. 10 people having 10 acre of land, it makes 100 acre. So not that 10 acre land having 10 people having 10 acre of land were engaged into agriculture. There was someone who used to bring certain raw materials. There was someone who used to sell those agricultural products. So all of them are affected. Livelihoods are impacted, not only of the owner of the land, but also of people who used to be associated with the with that land in any capacity. Maybe a weekly market was held there, maybe a Sunday market or a Monday market, and someone used to sell something on those weekly market, and he has been doing this for the last 10 years. So he's also impacted. That is what SIA does. It studies the analysis, it analyzes the impact that it will have on people living there, irrespective of who owns the land. So now it's not like that you can just drive away people. There are much to it. You have to study land reforms in paper 3, the PDS and land reforms when you will study the economy section of your main exam. So I'm not going into much details. Let us see what is here in the book. With the TMS taking over, the fish workers were able to increase their earnings substantially. This was because they set up the cooperative. What is a cooperative? 10 people pull up their resources, it becomes a cooperative, which would buy the catch from them at a fair price. The cooperative would then arrange the transport and say, see, one person will not be able to do these things. He will be not be able to catch and sell at a fair price. He won't be able to organize the logistics part, transport, and selling it to market where it gets a remunerative price. This is where cooperative comes into play. They have now begun to earn 3 times more than they have earned earlier. TMS also began giving the fisherworks loans for repair and the buying of new nets. People pool their resources so that when it's as and when it is needed, they can borrow from that. Okay, and if you don't pool your resource at some time, then maybe you have to pay some interest. So it benefits all the stakeholders who are involved there. Cooperatives now have a constitutional mandate, and it is there in your Indian Constitution book, which we will study later on. So see how protests have been carried on and how people through these protests have made the government of the day hear what they want to say and act upon it. Now, Indian Constitution is a living document. We will discuss this in a great details later on, but here I would like to tell you what it means. This is what Dr. Ambedkar said, that Indian Constitution is not a dead but a living document, which means it will keep improving with the demands of the country. It's not like, see, we have had more than 100 amendments to our constitution. We often say that ours is the best constitution in the world. This is the reason we say that ours is the best constitution, because it has adapted with time. Constitution makers knew that what is appealing to be, what is appearing to be good in 1950 might not hold true in 2020. The mode of doing business would change. The production process would change. Even that concept of justice would change. We have decriminalized Section 377, right? The homosexual law that was there. It penalizes unnatural sex. However, it does not penalizes homosexuals. Why? Because the concept of morality has changed, which existed when this law was made under IPC to the current day. So constitution makers were well aware of this fact that things will change, and so does this document need to change. You see, if the water is flowing, it's pure. If it's stuck, it will start stinking and there will be so many mosquitoes which will cause several diseases. Indian constitution is not like a mosquito breeding pond. It's a regular fresh water is flowing from it. It's a living document. That is what is called constitution as a living document, something that has real meaning in our lives. There are always communities and individuals trying to expand the idea of democracy and push for a greater recognition of equality on existing as well as new issues. Now, we have much to talk on these issues, that how far you can go to challenge the popular mandate of the government. So for as per this book is concerned, we will confine ourselves to this aspect only, that Indian constitution is a living document, which means the citizen of this country can well go against the government. There is a way in which democracies allow you to express your disconcern, your anger, your displeasure with the government, and that is why it is called a living document. It's not fixed. It will change as per the situation. And as I told you, there has been more than 100 amendments to this constitution, which is an empirical evidence of the fact what our constitution maker envisioned, that Indian constitution is a living document. So this is where we have completed the class 7th NCERT. Now slowly we are coming to those texts who are a little complicated, not much in class 8th also. But yeah, you will learn new things, new ideas, and this will come very handy when we will study the advanced text, when we will study the optional, when we will study the Indian constitution in great details. Now you know the meaning of these terms, living document, what is prejudice, what is preconceived notion, because we have done NCERTs. So please do it properly and please send your answers so that I can get back to you. I'll soon do it very, very soon, maybe tomorrow itself. So please take good care and happy reading to all of you.